How did the church start? Let's go there. Well, the church started 50 days after Jesus' ascension to heaven. I'm sorry, after the Passover, not the ascension, after the Passover. The day that we call the day of Pentecost. And I want to read what this looked like, the day of Pentecost. Day of Pentecost is in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. This is exactly how the church started. And this is important to know. Why is this important to know? It's important to know because it will let us know whether we have fallen off the rails or whether we're still right there. Are we still on track with what the church is and was always meant to be? Or have we missed it somehow? This is where the church started. First day of the church. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Who is they? Who is they that were together? These were the disciples, people that had been following Jesus around. After Jesus ascended back to heaven, the disciples were left alone, but they were together. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So let me just bring that so that you understand it. Bunch of Christians, about 120 of them, were sitting together, praying, seeking God's face. Suddenly a wind, a mighty rushing wind, comes into the room. Tongues of fire are above their heads. They're seeing like these tongues, these flaming tongues. And what happens? Suddenly they begin to speak in other tongues. Now, I don't want you to take it too far. What they were speaking mainly was different languages. Languages that they had not learned as children. Languages that they never went to school to learn. Languages that they didn't even know how they were speaking those languages, but suddenly they're speaking all these different languages. Now, there was a purpose for this, but let's go a little further and then we'll discuss that. Now, they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. So what's happening is, because of the Feast of Pentecost, there were Jews from all over the place, Jews that spoke different languages, and they were coming into Jerusalem. They were there. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one of them heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Wait, aren't these those who are speaking Galileans?" So to them, it's a little different. It would be like you walking into a room and suddenly hearing a bunch of Spanish people maybe speaking Italian. Like you would say, "Wait, how are they speaking Italian? All these Spanish people, aren't they?" They said, "Aren't they Galileans? They shouldn't be speaking this language. This is not native to them." Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? They're like, "This is not right. Like this is not right. These people should not be speaking like this." Now, I put three dots there because there's a bunch of different nationalities presented there. And I thought, for brevity's sake, let's just skip that. But you are welcome to go read it, Acts chapter 2. And this is ultimately what they're hearing. This is important. Especially for us Pentecostals. This is important for us to hear. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. What were they saying? That is important. What were they speaking? The language matters, but is not as important as what they were saying in that language. What were they saying in that language? The Bible says that they were declaring the wonders of God. Declaring the wonders of God. You know what they were doing? They were praising God. They were praising God. And everyone around heard them declaring the praises of God. And they heard it in their own tongue and in their own language. This is the very first day of the church. The very first day, what is happening? People are praising God in multiple languages. See, I believe that's what heaven is going to be like. Multiple ethnicities, multiple languages, multiple tribes, multiple tongues worshiping God together. So they're understanding them. Some theologians believe, and I agree with them, that this was in some ways a reversal of what happened at the Tower of Babel. Remember the Tower of Babel, where the Tower of Babel, what happened was that because man was trying to exert himself and was trying to make himself greater with the Tower of Babel, what did God do? God confused the tongues. But here in the book of Acts, we see that God is not confusing tongues. He's bringing things back into order. He's saying, no, you're going to declare my goodness. You're going to declare my wonders in every tongue. We read a little later on. What happened then? Because everybody's confused. Peter stands up and Peter's ready to preach. And Peter, he preaches a lengthy sermon. I'm going to bypass that sermon again. You can go back and read it. But I'm going to tell you his concluding statements in his sermon. This is what he says. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this man Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. So Peter, remember Peter, wimpy Peter, the one that denied Christ three times? All of a sudden now he's bold because he gets this empowerment from the Holy Spirit. Now he stands up in all boldness, and this is what he tells them. He says, you know what this is all about? This is the infilling of the Holy Spirit in our lives, and you know what this is in response to? This all comes because of our relationship with Jesus. This comes from Jesus. This is all about Jesus. He says, watch, he says, this Jesus, and then he says, whom you crucified. That's not a very friendly sermon, is it? They're like, Peter, tell us, what is this whole thing about? He says, remember Jesus who you killed? Remember Jesus that you put on a cross and crucified? This is all about that Jesus. Do you think they were convicted at all? Like, us? Like, oh, we messed up. That was a mistake. He says, it's that Jesus. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were cut to the heart. They felt a heavy amount of conviction. Just strong conviction. Have you ever been there where you felt strong conviction? Like I'm talking like really bad conviction. I've told you already that in the past, I have hurt my own feelings as I've been praying sometimes, really confessing to God sins inside of me, and I've hurt my own feelings in the past. I picked up a book from David Platt some time ago. The book is called Radical. It talks about radical Christianity, and it's probably not what you're thinking about. But I opened up that book, and in the first few pages, I was so convicted that I had to close the book. Because I knew that what he was saying was so true. But it was so true that it was as if I was in a dark room and somebody all of a sudden turned on really bright lights. And I couldn't take it. And you might say, well, were you a Christian then? Yes, I was a Christian. Were you a pastor then? Yes, I was a pastor then. And I just couldn't take the conviction, and I closed the book. Now, I got back to the book eventually. But sometimes it is important that we get cut to the heart. It is important that we have that conviction. They are cut to the heart. And Peter says, brothers, what shall we do? They ask Peter. Peter replies, you know what you do? Now that you feel that conviction, he says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. He says, repent and be baptized. This is the beauty about God. that even though he can convict us, he also gives us a way to deal with that conviction. That there's a way out. That it's not like he says, you're awful, terrible people, period. No. He says, look, maybe you are awful and maybe you are terrible. But let me tell you, it's very easy. All you have to do is repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus. And he says, you'll be saved and you'll receive the gift of the promised Holy Spirit. Later on, and I don't have time to go over all of it, that same day, the Bible says that about 3,000 of them committed their lives to Jesus. Committed their lives to Jesus. That is when the church started.